A very good afternoon, students, and a warm welcome to all those who are present today for the lecture of second year BCom semester 3 for the subject business administration. Now you have been attending number of lectures in BA, and you already know that in the previous few lectures we have started discussion on the third chapter of unit 1 that talks all about human resource planning. In the previous lectures, we have understood the meaning of human resource planning as to how do we estimate the manpower demand, the manpower supply, and thereby both of them have to be brought at a desirable level. We have studied about the different characteristics of human resource planning. In the previous lecture, we also discussed about the factors affecting human resource planning, such as the internal factors within the control of the organization and the external factors which are beyond the control of the business organization. And in the last lecture, we started the discussion on the procedure of human resource planning as well. We have done half of the process already. So the focus for today's lecture shall be to understand the remaining process of how does human resource planning take place. So before we move on with the process, have a quick glimpse at whatever we have covered in the chapter. So students, you have covered with the definition of human resource planning. We have talked about the characteristics of human resource planning. We have discussed about the different factors affecting human resource planning. So I hope you remember both the categories, namely internal and external, one within the control of organization and the other beyond its control. These were some four factors each which we had discussed in both internal and external respectively. We have discussed about external factors such as technological factors, social factors, the economic factors, and the political and the legal factors. Now, in the previous lecture, we had discussed about a new topic that was the process or the procedure of human resource planning. As to what steps were to be undertaken, what was the sequence of the steps in order to plan the human resource in an organization? So I hope you remember the steps we discussed, which begins with determining the goal of the company, collecting data about the existing manpower, forecasting manpower demand, estimating manpower supply, and lastly, to take an action plan with which the demand and supply can be brought to a desirable balance. In the previous lecture, I have already talked upon the first and the second step of human resource planning procedure, that is to determine the goal and thereby collect data about the existing manpower. So in few minutes, I would give you a quick recap of both the steps, and thereby we begin discussion of the remaining three steps of the process of human resource planning. So pay your keen attention for the first two steps once again so that you understand the remaining process better. So students, the first step, if you remember, human resource planning had to begin with determining the goal of the company. And I hope you remember that with goal, we did not mean only the short-term goals, or let us say the basic goal of profit maximization or maximum return on investment. But we were determining detailed list of objectives. Such detailed list would help the organization plan out for the human resource requirement. It could be developing quality of the work, it could be enhancing the performance. So these kind of goals have to be listed down, and thereby the labor needs, or I can say what kind of labor is required, what should be the skills possessed by them, can be decided. So the goals have to be clearly spelled out, detailed list of objectives to decide the labor need as to how many laborers are required and what kind of skill should they possess. To give you example, it could be skilled workers, semi-skilled or unskilled workers. Thereby, the second step talks about collecting data about the existing manpower. Now, once you have decided with the goal, you have determined the goals, now you have to collect data as to the existing manpower which is already working in your organization. Because before we actually determine the demand and supply, you need to pay your attention to the number of laborers who are already available in the organization. So the data pertaining to that has to be collected. There were a few methods which we had discussed. Number one, that was manpower inventory. So I hope the meaning is clear to you. Here, inventory does not mean the raw materials or the finished goods, but we are talking about the inventory of manpower. That is to say, the inventory of human resources which are already present in your organization. We need to bifurcate them based on their age, based on the skills that they possess, based on the education, qualifications, and whatnot, so that we get an idea as to what kind of labor is there in the organization and what needs to be recruited in future. It may happen that you already have the human resources, but they need to be given the sufficient training. So it will be decided once we are done with manpower inventory. The second method we discussed was about manning tables. So I hope you are clear that manning tables were the tables showing the list of all the jobs and all the employees who are working currently on the same, with which you can understand a gap between how many employees are presently available, how many will be needed in future. So once you know the gap between the two, recruitments can take place very easily. Let us say the employees are 100 in number, but you are in need of 110. By understanding this gap of 10 employees, the company can work for further recruitment. Next was inventory about the skills. So just like we did manpower inventory, this is inventory of the skills possessed by the human resource in your organization. So I hope you remember, we had talked about different skills. It could be a simple educational skill, or it could be a special kind of hobby that the person possesses, a passion, maybe any knowledge of a foreign language, maybe any other kind of art form that he is aware of. All these things should also be taken care of, so that when in future the work is to be assigned to the employee, his skills could be taken care of. It may happen that a manager is also good in writing, so he could be given some work pertaining to editing, or could be given some work of a journalist and whatnot. So those skills should be taken into consideration. Thereby, lastly, the method was manpower audit. And I hope you remember that manpower audit had to be done only after doing the first three steps. Because once you have inventory of manpower, you have inventory about their skills, you also have prepared the manning tables. Now comes the task of auditing. That is to systematize, examine, and analyze them thoroughly. It will help you answer a number of questions pertaining to recruitment, absenteeism of labor, labor turnover rate, competition going on, population around the company, could be the standard of performance of the company, etc. So these were all the methods that we had discussed about how data can be collected about the existing manpower. I would give you a minute. You can have a look at all the steps which we had studied separately. And then we begin with understanding of step number 3 of HRP procedure. So students, we had understood about manpower inventory. Please pay attention to what is written, that it is inventory of the existing personnel. We discussed manning tables, which would show you the list of jobs and the employees working on those jobs, thereby analyze the gap and make further recruitments. It could be the skills inventory, showing the different skills possessed by the employees. So such skills could be educational and other qualifications, could be knowledge of a foreign language, job experience, could be skill and expertise, or could be other merits or skill. So one has to get complete data about the past experience of the employee, because as a manager, your task is to give the right job to the right person, which could be done better if you know about their hidden skills and talents too. And lastly, the information has to be systematized, examined, explained, and evaluated thoroughly. So it would be answering different questions for an organization altogether. So I hope that with this, you are clear with the first two steps of HRP procedure. To repeat myself, we have determined the goals and thereby we have collected the data pertaining to the existing manpower. So students, do you remember the next steps now? Now we have to work on with estimating the demand, estimating the supply, and thereby bringing both of them into balance. So let us first understand all about manpower demand. So here comes the third step of human resource planning procedure, that is forecasting manpower demand. Now, once you have decided the goals, you also have collected the data about the existing human resources already employed. Now you have to forecast as to what is the demand of manpower. How many workers or how many human resources are actually required in the organization? So you would say, why should we forecast? Why can't we just recruit as and when required? Because there are number of changes taking place in the same. There are number of factors that tends to affect the manpower demand. And the same you have to study. The first factor that you can see affecting manpower requirement is the trend of employment. Now by trend, we mean to understand whether the employees are sticking to the company or not. That is to say, the tendency of the employee to stay in the organization for a longer period of time. It may be that employees are there with the organization at a stable trend, or it may be that they are quite unstable. They join the organization and thereby they leave also in the near future. So based on this trend of either staying in the organization or leaving the organization, one can get to know about the manpower demand. So as a manager, one can pay attention to the trend of, say, last 5 years and thereby understand the tendency of human resources staying or leaving from the organization. Number two, the factor is replacement needs. Now, in an organization, it happens many a times that employees need to be replaced. Why? So because employees may either die, maybe they are dismissed from the organization, maybe they voluntarily resign from their jobs, maybe they are transferred, maybe they get promoted, they get demoted. So due to all these factors, it tends to create vacancies, it tends to create gaps, and these gaps have to be filled. So replacement need is again a factor that would affect the manpower demand. We need to appoint persons to fill the vacancies that may arise due to any sort of reason that I mentioned. So this also has to be taken care of by forecasting manpower demand as to which vacancies are likely to be created in future due to number of reasons we discussed. Of course, the past experience could give a rough estimate about the same. Thereby, productivity changes. Now, productivity of laborers is also affected by many reasons. Could be the technology. Maybe there is a new technology being introduced with complete automation, which is, after all, increasing the labor productivity. It could be also understood by few studies. If you have known about time study, motion study, with these studies, one can decide the average time a person requires to complete a task, or with how many movements can the person, average person, complete the task. So with these studies, one can analyze the productivity of laborers. if the productivity is higher, more production can be undertaken even with less number of workers, and vice versa. So even this factor would affect manpower demand. Let us say if the laborers are not showing enough productivity, more laborers may be recruited. But if lesser number of workers are able to give higher productivity, one can go off with those many employees itself. And lastly, a very simple factor is expansion and development. Now, this is very simple to understand, that when an organization is planning for expansion, is going for development in the near future, it will definitely require more workers for its operations. Because when a business expands, its operations increase, for which laborers are required, human resources required, and thereby it would affect manpower demand. So I hope that you are clear with all the factors that affects the forecasting of manpower demand, that either increases the demand or decreases the demand. With understanding the factors affecting, I would also now explain you what are the different methods through which manpower demand can be forecasted. Because by now we know that manpower demand has to be forecasted. We have also understood why it has to be forecasted by understanding these factors. But now also you have to understand as to which are the methods of forecasting manpower demand. So let us understand them. The methods of demand forecasting are basically two that you have to understand. First being workload analysis, and the second being workforce analysis. I've tried to simplify both the methods for you. Just pay your keen attention. The first method that you see of demand forecasting is workload analysis. Now, when I say workload analysis, here we shall be analyzing as to how many workers are required for a given amount of production. I would repeat myself again. Let us say we want a production of certain units. So by the workload analysis, we can decide as to how many laborers will be required to do the necessary production. How would we be able to analyze the same? So we need to get an idea that how many hours a worker has to work for a given production, and based on the hours, we can decide the number of laborers required. So it is to estimate the labor required per unit of output. For one unit, how many laborers are required? So the same can be multiplied with the total production, and you will get the total number of laborers required. So how it will be done? So first of all, the work that is to be performed by each department has to be understood. The work is to be converted into man hours, that is to say, in how many hours the work will be completed, based on which you can understand the total labor required. Now I have put an example for better understanding. Let us say 18,000 components are to be manufactured in a department in a month. 1 month, 18,000 components are to be produced. For producing one component, 0.10 man hours are needed. So you very well know that for one unit, it is 0.10. So for 18,000 units, it will be 18,000 multiplied by 0.10. So 1,800 man hours will be needed. Now, one employee can work for 180 hours in a month. So 1800, that is the total man hours required, divide by the hours for which one employee works, it will give you 10 employees that will be needed by the department. So I hope that you got yourself very clear with this example. I give you 10 seconds, again read the example, and thereby understand the first method, that is workload analysis. It is good to explain the method with an example, so you can do so when you prepare the answer. So workload analysis would be useful for such short-term planning because output is affected by number of unpredictable forces. So of course, this method cannot be used for long-term, but at least can go for short-term planning. Another question comes, which method should we go for long-term planning of human resource? So it is your second method, that is workforce analysis. So students, to repeat myself, we have been doing the third step of HRP procedure, that was forecasting the manpower demand. We have understood the factors affecting manpower demand. We started understanding the methods of forecasting, with which we have done the first workload analysis, and now we do the second workforce analysis. As I said, it is a method for long-term planning or long-term projections. And here also, manpower demand is basically computed by understanding two factors. There are two major factors that would affect the demand under workforce analysis. The first, that you are very well aware of, absenteeism. The more the workers remain absent in your organization or they don't work, would definitely affect the manpower demand. That is to say, under absenteeism, we need to find out the man days lost. Let us say if total man days to be worked were 26 in a month, out of which 6 days a person remains absent. So that would be the rate of absenteeism. That would be the man days lost. Definitely would affect the production and the sales. So management has to take into consideration that there should not be high rate of absenteeism. And if there is, it should be removed by taking corrective measures. And the second major step that you might have heard, labor turnover. Labor turnover is basically the rate at which employees leave the organization. So even the degree of stability of the workforce has to be determined. They may be leaving the organization for a number of reasons, but that would affect manpower demand. So I hope that with this, you are clear with the third step of human resource planning, that was estimating manpower demand. Now students, if the third step was demand, I hope you know which would be the fourth step. It would be about manpower supply. So here comes the fourth step, estimating manpower supply. Hereby, you have to estimate the sources from where the supply of labor can be obtained. It could be an internal source and it could be an external source as well. So let us first understand the internal sources of labor. But again, the internal sources of labor suffers with few problems, in which the first is analysis of retention. Now, by analysis of retention, we mean to say the rate with which the number of employees leave the organization during a specific year. When workers are leaving the organization for any sort of reason, it is actually a wastage of labor for the organization. So by the analysis of retention or by computing the labor turnover rate, one needs to decide as to how many workers have left the organization out of the total number of workers who are already working. It could be for any reason, but for an organization, it is not a good sign when workers tend to leave the organization. So that would be affecting the internal source of labor. Secondly, the stability index. Now, with this index, the manager can compute the number of employees who are staying with the organization for a longer period of time. That is to say, maybe a year. So out of the total number of workers, stability rate would indicate those many workers who have stayed in the organization throughout the year. And lastly, analysis of internal movement. Now by labor turnover rate, we meant the number of employees leaving the firm during a year. By stability index, we meant the number of employees who stick to their job during a year. But by the internal movement, we mean the movement of workers taking place within the organization. It could be a transfer from one department to another. It could be a sort of promotion taking place. It could be a transfer. It could be a demotion. So even these things would create some vacancies or some posts lying idle, which needs to be filled. So these were all about the internal sources of labor supply. As you can see, the next has to be external. So when the internal sources are not adequate enough, or when laborers are not available adequately from the internal sources, the manager would also try to now tap the external sources. That is to say, the search of labor from outside market. It could be paying attention to some campus recruitments, or it could be from the office publications. It could be the data supplied by the government, could be the population census data. So this kind of data would help the organization get information on the external sources of labor. So this was how the manpower supply has to be estimated. And lastly, the fifth step that you see, it is to take an action plan now for human resource planning. We have estimated demand, we have forecasted the supply. But if you remember, the definition very well taught you that HRP is to bring a balance between demand and supply at a desirable level. So lastly, the organization needs to take that action plan with which both supply and demand come to a balance. Along with that, it has to pay attention that the manpower requirements are in balance with the financial position of the company as well, because human resource procedures are expensive too. So even the budget consideration has to be paid due attention. The four elements of final plan are as follows. So once you are making action plan, it should be considering manpower utilization, manpower supply, training, and the personnel policies. So you need to use the manpower already available. If not, you have to consider the supply of the same. The existing ones can be trained. And lastly, the personnel policies, that is to say the human resource policies, have to be prepared. As I said, it is based on the availability of labor with the financial capacities of the company. It always has to be in balance with the budget of the organization also. So this was all about the procedure of human resource planning. I give you a quick recap. We have done with determining of goals of the company. Thereafter, we have collected data about the existing manpower. We have estimated the manpower demand. So I showed you different methods of estimating manpower demand, such as workload analysis, workforce analysis. We have discussed number four, estimating manpower supply, where we discussed the internal sources and the external sources of labor. Lastly, number five, we have undertook an action plan, bringing the demand and the supply to a desirable balance. With this, I finished the topic for today. We are still left with two other topics for the chapter, that is to say advantages and the limitations of human resource planning that we would be taking up in the next lecture. Before I wind up, you can have a quick review of whatever we have done up till now. So just have a glimpse at all the points that have been covered. Of course, you need to describe every point in detail, and the answer is a lengthy answer in the entire chapter. So this way you will be explaining every point and its sub-points in detail. Have a quick look at all the five steps that we have discussed by today in detail. And I hope that you are clear with all the five. That is to say, determining goal, existing manpower data, manpower demand, manpower supply, and a plan taken for maintaining a balance. So students, this was all for today. I hope that you are clear with whatever we discussed up till now. I gave you a quick revision of the chapter, and then we have finally finished the human resource planning procedure. For any doubts whatsoever, feel free to post them in Google Classroom of your respective class, and I shall be answering to them at the earliest. See you soon in the next lecture, where we would finish the chapter by understanding the advantages and the limitations of human resource planning. Thank you so much for the day. Until then, happy learning.